Hello, and welcome to the first ever inaugural episode of the Lebanese Politics Podcast, where we talk about all things Lebanese politics right before leading up to the Lebanese election on May 6th. It is a little bit late in the game for us to be getting into this, but all the same, we are going to take you through everything that we possibly can leading up to the elections and then probably a little bit after the elections as well. So you understand exactly what's going on within Lebanon, within Lebanon politics, and within the campaigns that are going on. My name is Benjamin Redd. I'm a journalist with the Daily Star, the newspaper here in Beirut. I cover elections for them mostly up in the north and also a bit here in Beirut. I'll probably be doing a few other places. I'm joined by Nizar Hassan, who is a brilliant nerd at the Lebanese Center for Policy Studies. He is also an insane activist. He works for Tahalif Watani, or works with the Tahalif Watani coalition, who they're contesting the elections this year. Nizar, tell us what you do exactly for LCPS.
So what I do at LCPS is basically a policy, public policy research. So we do research about public policies and the in terms of economic policies and social policies. And now we're monitoring, we also monitor the executive and legislative authorities and their performances. So my work is mostly focused on that.
Okay, but then in addition to that, you are working, you're volunteering in the elections with the Tahalif Watani, the National Coalition. Tell us about your work with them.
So yeah, what happened is that when I came back to Beirut 6 months ago, there was a campaign happening in Shouf, and then it expanded to Alay. So it's an independent campaign called Lihaqi, which is literally for my rights. And it has a relatively progressive and very grassroots nature. And then when the Tahalif Watani was being founded, our group was one of the founders of Tahalif Watani. So now we're working as a list called Kulluna Watani, the same name for all the lists in, across the countries. And Kulluna Watani, which was formerly known as Tahalif Watani, is including activist groups and some a very few number of political parties.
All right, so you are an activist, but we are going to keep you honest, and we're just going to analyze things on this podcast, but we're very happy to have your perspective on everything as well. So the idea with this podcast is that we are going to be coming to you every Monday morning with the latest updates, what happened over the past week, and then digging a little bit deeper into a few issues on each podcast. But this for this first episode, though, we really have to set the basic context and lay out the field, explain what's going on. So we're going to try to do that as briefly as possible, and we'll see if that works. Okay, so let's set the stage here, Nizar. It's been a really, really long time since the last elections. The last elections, the last national elections in Lebanon were back in 2009. 9 years ago was the last time the Lebanese voter had a chance to elect any parliamentarian at all. These same 128 or now 125 people have basically been sitting in their seats, haven't had to run for anything for the past 9 years, and a lot has gone on during that time. So, of course, first off, they've had to, like, extend their own term of parliament 3 different times, which has not been the most popular thing to do in a supposedly democratic society. But there were a lot of sort of reasons, like, I guess you could say reasonable reasons for doing this. There was just this major political sclerosis during this time. We had a period of 2.5 years, something like that, of no president from 2014 to 2016. We had long periods where there were resigned governments still just like carrying out basic day-to-day business, but they were technically resigned, so they had limited powers. We had security problems because of the war in Syria sort of spilling over back in 2013, for instance. There was a whole lot of stuff going on with, because of all these problems, the central bank had to create all of these crazy monetary stimulus and extraordinary monetary policies sort of to prop up the Lebanese economy. And of course, then you also had the Syrian refugees fleeing conflict in Syria who were here, who, I mean, the Lebanese, there were a lot of things going wrong in the Lebanese system with infrastructure and everything like that. But this influx of refugees sort of added to the strain of the system as well. And amongst all of this, one of the big things that happened was in 2015, there was the closure of one of the major garbage landfills right near Beirut. There was a massive garbage crisis. Mm-hmm. And can you sort of walk us through what happened with that and why that's important for the elections?
Mm-hmm. The momentum started basically with the first extension of the parliament, with the movement against the extension of parliament.
So this is in 2013,
the first one, which was extended. The pretext was the security issues happening in the north, that they could not handle the elections now with all the security threats. However, it was not convincing enough to a lot of people, so there was a movement against the election extension. And this is where the momentum started, more or less. It manifested in 2014 again with the second extension of the parliament term. And then in 2015 with the garbage crisis, as you said, they closed the Nami landfill. The garbage was piling up in the streets. And the movement started happening basically quite spontaneously among what is called civil society activists, people working in small groups, not really parties, mostly very small organizations, mostly active on the media scene, on the online media scene. And then things started accumulating. We had maybe the biggest independent protest movement in Lebanon since the Civil War. This was in summer 2015. And starting then, you've had this different political dynamics related to independent political organizations. So we've had the municipal elections in 2016, where in a lot of different villages and towns and cities, including Beirut, civil society and independent activists created lists against ruling class, lists against the lists combining different forces of the.
Can I just back up just a little bit on the garbage crisis? This was such a major thing, because literally garbage was piling up all over the capital. People were setting it on fire. So there were garbage fires going on across the capital. And we had thousands of people coming out sometimes on a nightly basis, down to downtown in front of the Grand Sarai, which is the governmental seat of government in downtown Beirut. And they were being sprayed by water cannons from the internal security forces. It was this period of really massive unrest because of the government's inability to provide basic services. And that's what, just to give a taste of mm-hmm. what propelled all of this. So then this sort of goes into the 2016 municipal elections and propels it there, right?
Exactly. And you had the manifestation was in independent lists being formed in different places against the established parties list. And in Beirut, we had the phenomenon of Beirut Madinati, which was quite successful, gathering 40% of the votes, but obviously not getting any seats because of the majoritarian electoral law that was in place. Then we had the elections in the Order of Engineers and many liberal profession orders that also accumulated this momentum until we reached the present moment.
Yeah, and I think so that's one of the big stories that leads into this year's elections, this new civil society movement, this pent-up frustration at a political class that has proved in many cases feckless, and by their own admission. You talk to politicians and they say, yeah, we are unable to do this, we understand why people are mad, but they tend to blame the other politicians, right? It's everyone pointing fingers at each other, and so you have this third party momentum, sort of, mm-hmm. so to speak. That's one of the main developments, the emergence of civil society as a political force. One of the other big things just ever present in Lebanese politics, though, is Lebanon's relationship to Damascus. And this has canonically been since 2005 expressed in the March 14th sort of anti-Syrian versus March 8th pro-Syrian camps. Before the podcast started, before we started recording, Nizar, I was making the point that the lines were very blurred, and this didn't really matter as much as it used to, this distinction between March 8th, March 14th. But is that really the case? Is the March 8th, March 14th distinction dead?
Well, I don't think it's dead for many reasons, but mostly because the position that was previously from the Syrian regime itself is now in alignment with some regional political force. So we're talking about Iran and Saudi Arabia now. And the main political divide between the future movement headed by Prime Minister Hariri and Hezbollah on the other side, each of them having their own strong Christian political parties as allies, is still about this regional alignment. So you have the Lebanese forces on the Hariri side, the FPM on the Hezbollah side. These two Christian parties sometimes might have alliance together, but they're still on different camps.
And just to piggyback on that really quickly, the relationship with Syria, between Lebanon and Syria, it's just naturally important, and especially as the Syrian war, it appears to be coming to a close right now. Assad appears to have basically won and is consolidating his gains, unless something late in the game changes that. And so in these elections, it's really important because all of the parties are trying to set the stage for what their relationship will be with Damascus after the elections.
I agree.
Okay, so we've set the stage, talked about the general context of the elections, but let's get into the, what the fuck is going on with the electoral law? All right, basically, how are these elections being conducted? You know, the first thing that really stands out, right, is that this is a proportional law. This is from time immemorial. Lebanese elections have been conducted on the basis of first past the post. If you got a plurality of the votes, if you beat the other guy, you're an MP. But for the past several years, a lot of support has been growing for a proportional system, be more fair, give better representation to the population, to the Lebanese public. So the politicians got together, and they did a proportional system in name, but it's not really a proportional system, because in a real proportional system, smaller parties have a chance of really breaking into parliament, and that's not really the case under the system. Basically, the electoral districts, Lebanon's a small country to begin with, right? About 4 million people, small area. They divided the country up into 15 districts, and they divided up the 128 parliament seats amongst those districts. So you have these sky-high electoral thresholds. You know, I think the lowest electoral threshold is something like 8%.
In the district of Shufan Ali, 7.5%.
Right. But it goes all the way up to 20% in South One, which is Saida City and Jizin. 20%. So that is, first off, 7.5%. That's above what a proportional system should be for electoral threshold. It should be 5 at the maximum from experts that I've spoken to. So going from that as a minimum to as high as 20%, it's not a real proportional system. And then there's another thing that they added into this, which is the preferential vote. So let's take a step back here. Do you want to explain this, or should I? Okay, all right. So we're gonna take a deep dive really quickly, and then we're gonna come back up for air, right? So Lebanon is divided into 15 districts. Within these districts, there are sometimes sub-districts, okay? And that's going to be important for later. So sometimes there's not. Sometimes, in North One, it's just the first northern district. It's just one district. There's no subdivisions. In Beirut, Beirut One, it's just a district. There's no subdivision. Same with Beirut Two. But in Saida Jizin, for instance, as the name implies, there are two sub-districts, Saida and Jizin. In Tripoli, Minya, Diniyeh, there are three sub-districts, Tripoli, Minya, and Diniyeh. Okay, so the reason that the sub-district is important is when you as a voter go to vote, say you're voting in Tripoli, Minya, Diniyeh, the list is for the entirety. You have candidates for Tripoli, candidates for Diniyeh, and the one candidate for Minya, right? But you can only cast a preferential vote. You get one preferential vote. You can only cast that for somebody on the list that you're voting for in your subdistrict. So let's say you're voting in the NIE, but you really like one of the candidates in Tripoli, you can't vote for them. You have to vote for one of the candidates in the NIE if you're going to cast a preferential vote at all. And the important thing about the way that the subdistricts are apportioned is that the preferential vote is not just a basic count of, oh, you got more preferential votes, therefore you get. So the point of the preferential vote is to give you higher billing on your list, right? So if you're more popular, then you get a higher position within your list. And when the seats are allocated, then like you have dibs, basically, if you've got a lot of votes. But the way it's done, it's not a straight one-to-one count. It's done as a percentage of your subdistrict. So in small subdistricts, then a vote, a preferential vote, counts a lot more than in a big district. So it's really easy to get a high preferential vote if you're a candidate in Minier, but it's hard if you're a candidate in Tripoli, even though those candidates are on the same list. So that introduces some really crazy dynamics into the race, which we'll get into later. But the other thing that we want to get into is that the preferential vote, like why have it? And we were talking about this before the podcast, right? And we were talking about, well, it makes sense for it to be a minority thing. If you're a strong minority, you can all get together and cast your preferential votes for the candidate that you actually want. And then theoretically, they get in, right? Because they have the high, so tough daily, the high preferential vote. And that's important historically, though, right?
I agree. It's very important historically, especially that when we speak of minorities in Lebanon, we're speaking of sectarian minorities specifically. So the seats are allocated, specific numbers of seats are allocated within the parliament for each sect. This is the foundation on which all of the elections is happening, any elections in Lebanon, as long as we have this sectarian quotas in parliament. And as you're saying, this is supposed to be the way that minorities can choose their own candidates within lists in parliamentary elections. And it's basically the result of the pressure that we saw from Christian political parties over the last 3 or 4 years, saying we cannot accept that Muslim voters elect Christian MPs anymore. We want to be electing our own MPs.
Right.
So we want a tool for this direct representation of us, of Christian electorates, Christian voters electing Christian MPs. So this is why the preferential vote happened, but its implications are...
But okay, so but that doesn't really work out in practice all the time. So I, for instance, I know this political operative in East Beirut, the Beirut 1 district. It's Christian, like all Christian MPs, for Armenians, for other Christians. And it has the one seat in parliament for the Christian minority sects. And I went through, based on the numbers that this guy gave me, I went through and there were, these are very reasonable numbers. This is definitely a possibility, like a very good possibility that things could work out this way. Based on his numbers, there were 12 possible scenarios. So I gamed it out, all 12 of the scenarios. In 11 of those 12 scenarios, the person with zero votes, literally zero votes, got the minority seat. How does that work? It somebody with zero votes could literally win a seat.
This is the crazy thing, but it also used to happen with the previous law, because in the previous law you had this one list that wins all seats regardless of its components, as long as it has the main political force in the district. But what you're saying is very important, because there are two scenarios that we can think of: either sectarian minorities organizing politically to elect their own candidates, so that politics becomes purely sectarian in any district we're talking about. And the other scenario is that this cannot happen because these minorities cannot get the threshold each for their own candidate, for their own seat.
Right.
So they will have to work in alliances like they're doing now, which makes it much more complicated. But on the long term, it still has the impact of making electoral politics in Lebanon more and more sectarian focused.
Mm. And so that's a danger, not necessarily for this election, but for the next election.
Exactly.
If we continue under the same law, that's insane. So big picture with this law, basically we've got this sectarian angle, but then we also have the fact that if you're on the same list, you're competing against your list mates for the preferential vote. It means that basically a lot of parties have settled on a strategy of, let's just put a couple of big names up there on the list and then a bunch of window dressing. Maybe they'll bring like 500 votes each or something. They're not going to get elected, but our big names will. And it's also meant that a lot of big names have dropped out because they definitely just won't be elected, according to what people are saying. Fouad Sanyora, the former prime minister, longtime MP from Saida, he dropped out of the race because, well... for probably a multitude of reasons, but one of which was people were saying he wasn't going to get elected. A similar story happened in the north of Tripoli with former finance minister Mohamed Safadi. And so for this reason, a lot of big names, they actually hate the law, right? A lot of the political class and a lot of the people outside the political class hate the law because the electoral threshold is so high. So it's there are a few people who like the law, but in my view, I think more people hate it than like it. What do you think?
I think from the strongest political parties, there's more, they are mostly pleased, but within them, they have different contradictions.
Yeah.
But it's certainly good for the main leaders of the political parties.
That being said, let's take a look at how the political parties are actually on the ground working in different districts here in Lebanon. So I'd like to draw a firm distinction from the beginning between basically the Amal Hezbollah alliance and their strategy and basically everybody else. Because the Amal Hezbollah, the two largest Shiite parties in the country, they're in an alliance, an electoral alliance with each other, and they're very strong in the south, in South 2, South 3, as well as in Bekaa 3, Baal-Bekermo. And their strategy in the south, at least, it makes a whole lot of sense. It's, okay, we are so strong here, the electoral threshold is so high, we are just going to get all of our partisans out to the polls, drive that electoral threshold so high, nobody else will be able to reach it, and we're going to dominate. We're going to take all of the seats in South 2, which is Zahrani and Sur. We're going to take all the seats in Nabatieh province. And then in Baal-Bekermel, they'll probably, there's a question, they're not going to take all of them, the polling tells us. But they're going to still take a lot. And if they mobilize people, they will take more.
If this happens, it makes it not so proportional anymore because it's acting as if it's a majoritarian law because of the threshold that you talked about. So
exactly.
If you don't have 15,000 people voting for one list, it doesn't mean that this list is not popular. If you have one vote less than you should, then you don't get any seats. So it still, to a certain extent, doesn't have the advantages of a proportional system.
Right. But it's smart given the lay of the land and the electoral law, right?
Exactly.
It allows for this strategy to really work, and it seems as though it's going to work from what people are saying. Like, oh yeah, the Hezbollah Amal list is going to do their lists are going to do very well. They'll probably have 35 seats in parliament, something like that. So they're going to be strong.
I think it's going to be very similar for Hariri and Beirut second, the districts where he's running, because all of the other lists are also much smaller and they have a very, very high challenge to actually get the threshold. So
yeah,
you might face the same thing and Hariri winning all of the seats.
You think all of the seats?
That's not my my data-driven prediction. It's just what I think is the dynamic in Beirut second is very similar to the dynamic in Zahrani, for example, in the south.
Yeah, yeah.
The chances of breaking through are very, very small.
Yeah. I know I spoke to one of the candidates this past week in Akkar, which is a future movement stronghold. They won all seven seats in the last elections. And he said that's their strategy in Akkar to go raise the Hasl Intikhabi, to raise the electoral threshold so high that nobody else gets in. But that is absolutely impossible. According to everybody else, it's just not going to work that way because they're not in the same position. The cards aren't stacked the right way for them in Akkar, at least, the same way that they are for Nabi Berri's Amal Party and Hezbollah in Saysur Zahrani. So I think with these other parties, with Future, like we're seeing other strategies come into play as well, which is just this tangle of alliances, mm-hmm. right? So you have like Mustaqbal, the Future Party, is allied with the LF, the Lebanese forces. In some places, they're allied with the FPM, the Free Patriotic Movement. Exactly. In other places, and there doesn't seem to be any like rhyme or reason ideologically for this, right?
I agree. There's absolutely no clear bottom line ideologically or policy-wise to why these alliances are taking place. There's nothing in common between the political platforms or the program, electoral programs of the Free Patriotic Movement and its main partner, Hezbollah. There's absolutely nothing, almost nothing in common in terms of the economic policies or even social policies. They disagree on everything, but this has, it doesn't change at all their political strategy in the elections, or even their political alliance in general and how they vote on a lot of things in parliament. So this is very interesting to point now that even the alliances that are happening between smaller groups and weaker groups in certain districts are not based on the project or the vision, but rather based on how many votes they can get and whether they can get the threshold.
Right. It's a very localized concern. It's like, okay, in this district, in District A, if we ally with these guys who we wouldn't normally ally with, we're going to get one more seat. So we're going to do that. But in their neighboring district, we're going to go with their enemies because we'll get another seat there or something, which is insane in a certain way, but there's a logic to it. Yep. So like the big picture that I've heard is that the Hezbollah Amal list, they're going to do well generally, but everybody else, there's a question as to how many seats they're going to lose. A lot of people are saying Future is going to lose seats. The LF, I'm not sure if they'll gain or lose. FPM, I'm not sure. What's your sense on that same? Or
I think in general, the main political parties will be winning where they didn't win before and losing where they didn't lose before. So they're going to be it's going to be more diverse, but the overall numbers, I don't think there are going to be drastic changes in them.
Yeah. And the other thing, though, is that just civil society, your friends, they're sort of screwed with this. The people that I've talked to have said basically they've got a chance at maybe one seat nationwide, maybe, which is under a proportional system, you would think the opposite would happen.
I think that's an underestimation, to say the least. I think we're talking more about 4 or 5 seats nationally. But the issue is that the numbers and the statistics...
He has to say that, by the way. Otherwise, they'll fire him.
No, I think that, first of all, the lists of the independent coalition, we launched 66 candidates last week. So people don't even know about them yet. In the next 3 weeks, people will be knowing that this is a choice, that it exists. So all the statistics that we've been hearing so far don't take this element into consideration. Everyone knows every political party in Lebanon almost, but not everyone knows that they have the choice of voting independent. Mm. So this will have a huge role, and also because now the donations are coming into these to the independent groups so that they can fund their campaigns, because before people were like, show us your candidates so we can show you the money. So now, I think if you do the same poll today and 10 days from now, you will have very different results in a lot of districts. That's what we're hoping for, at least. Yeah.
Well, we'll see. We've got 22 days, I think, until the election, right?
I think so.
And we're going to be back next week. We tried this episode to get through a lot of material. If you like what you're hearing, please tune in again next Monday. We'll be back with, I think, a little bit more, less ground to cover, for sure.
More focused, hopefully.
Yeah. Bear with us. We are broadcasting from a makeshift studio in Beirut. This is a learning process all around, but we're super happy to be coming to you. And please subscribe to us and tune in next week to the Lebanese Politics Podcast. Lebanese Politics Podcast is brought to you by myself, Benjamin Red, and Nizar Hassan, and also our brilliant behind-the-scenes producer, Susan Wilson. And special thanks as well to our...